So wish you all a very good morning on this second day of the AIOC 2019. We are going to have now an instruction course on dry eye. I'd like to request Dr. Muscati to please join me here on the dais, and all the other speakers to please come forward to the front row. I'd like to acknowledge that this instruction course has been very carefully planned and put together by Dr. Rishi Mohan. There was a personal commitment for which he was not able to attend the conference this year, so he requested me to take the responsibility. So it's my pleasure to be with you today. Give you a brief overview of the course, what we're going to do is we're going to give you initially a little bit about the update about the new paradigms in thinking about management of patients with ocular surface disease. Then give you some practical tips on how to diagnose and treat such patients, because there's a whole plethora of medications and a whole plethora of approaches and algorithms. And then give you a little bit about what are the new modalities of treatment and research ideas. So without further ado, I'd hand the floor to Dr. Quraish Muscati, and he's going to cover in a wonderful practical way how you approach the patients, which cases you suspect, or how you handle the tough cases of allergic eye disease and dry eye.
Next session. Thank you, Dr. Radhika. This, as Dr. Radhika mentioned, this course has been going on since the last 2-3 years. Curated by Dr. Rishi Mohan, and number one. Right at the outset, sometimes the dry eye is quite obvious, but sometimes we have trouble in diagnosing if there's a little red eye. What is exactly troubling the patient? Is it allergy? Is it infection? Is it dryness? Or is it some sort of combination of two of the three or all three, which can all happen? So sometimes some cases are a little confusing. So the idea of this small presentation is to see if we can lessen the confusion here. So when there are classical features of, say, allergy with large papillae on the bulbar conjunctiva, on the palpable conjunctiva, on the bulbar conjunctiva, Tranter's dots, things like this. There is you don't need a slit lamp, you don't need anything else. Patient says, I'm complaining of itching, and you look at the patient and he's got this picture, or he could have a shield ulcer, and you evert the lid and you got papillae there, and you treat the patient for allergy. Infections, if there is mucopurulent discharge from the eye, conjunctival congestion away from the limbal area, usually a bilateral case. There's an epidemic going on in the city. It could be viral. If there is a lot of pus, it could be bacterial. Most cases it is viral. But these again are fairly easy to diagnose, that this is pure infection and you can treat the patient preferably with no steroids, with just the mild anti-infectives to just keep it, prevent secondary bacterial infection. If they're viral, just using lubricant drops and some cold compresses would do the trick. And you get sometimes classical dry eye, patients coming to you with blinking disorders because of computer vision syndrome, a small filamentary keratitis, mucus at the canthus, squamous blepharitis, meibomitis. You can, if you want, do staining, squamous strips, and reduce TBUT, and you know that this is purely a case of dryness. So these are the classical appearance of these three conditions. But sometimes there is a confusion. What if there is allergy and dry eye? Can it happen? Yes. Child comes to you with years of allergy, anti-allergic treatment, all sorts of medicines have been put in the eye. Because of the allergy itself, he can develop dryness. Because of the medications and their preservatives, he can develop dryness. How will you diagnose that there is a superadded dryness to the allergy? Because otherwise, you will only treat the allergy and you will miss this, and the patient will not be completely all right. So go for a careful history. is the patient feeling any burning sensation? He's got sandy particle sensation, he's got itching in the eye. Is there also a burning sensation? Ask for it, because it's the children. They will not volunteer everything. Their vocabulary is not so great. But ask them whether they complain. Ask the parents if they sometimes tell the parents that there is a burning sensation in the eye. That's a dead giveaway that along with the allergy, there is some amount of dryness there. If you suspect this, especially in long-standing allergies, give a therapeutic trial. Add preservative-free lubricants to the allergy treatment. Is the patient significantly better? If the patient is significantly better by adding the lubricant, it's a therapeutic trial telling you that there is a super added dry eye and you need to take care of this as well. Tips to prevent, what about, as I told you, in conjunctival infections, you can get dry eye. You can get medicament also because we tend to over-treat conjunctival infections. So we talked about allergy and dry eye. Now this is infections which can cause dry eye. Please understand that most cases are viral, do not need topical antibiotics. Many times I've seen patient goes to Dr. A. Our patients also don't have patients anymore because they have Google with them. So they go to Dr. A who prescribes, say, the ciprofloxacin 4 times a day. And then in 2 days, they're not completely all right. So they go to Dr. B who says ciprofloxacin is old-fashioned. I'll give you something higher. And he goes to moxifloxacin. And then he goes to Dr. C who says moxifloxacin is not so broad spectrum. I'll give you 0.5% gatifloxacin and higher strength and so on. So he comes with a bag full of drops. Then the fourth guy says, well, all antibiotics have been tried, is not better still. Let me add some steroid to it. So he gives steroid antibiotic drops and so on. So the cycle perpetuates. So if an infection of the conjunctiva, I mention infection like this because again, most of these are viral, which are self-limiting. You just need to reassure the patient, cold compresses and lubricants is all that it needs. But if the patient has been treated for a week or 10 days and it has either worsened after initial treatment or it has not improved, suspect conjunctivitis medicamentosa because of abuse of the antibiotics or even sometimes keratitis medicamentosa can occur. What is the therapeutic trial for this? Stop the antibiotic drops. 10 days he has been on all sorts of medicines, stop them all. Replace with non-preserved lubricants, frequent use. Patient should feel better within 48 hours. And then if the patient is completely better, then very gingerly you can add surface acting steroids to reduce the inflammation because the purely inflammatory process which has occurred as a result of abuse of the antibiotics. So this is a patient whom I had who had some amount of chemosis as well. So this angry red eye was like this, waxing and waning since the last 15 days on all sorts of treatment. Symptoms typically of conjunctivitis or keratitis medicamentosa, initial improvement in the original condition, then apparent deterioration. When the usual symptoms with redness, lid swelling, blurred vision, you can even get chemosis as I showed you. And if it becomes keratitis medicamentosa, then you can even get punctate staining, chronic epithelial defects. Sometimes there is some allergic component like this, you get an allergic dermatitis type of picture. But otherwise you just get something like, it looks like a chronic conjunctivitis which is not improving. So there should be nothing like a chronic conjunctivitis which is not improving. So just stop antibiotics, add lubricants and the patient usually is better. So infection and dry eye tips. Many assume that all patients, now I'm talking about now patient of dry eye, Can he not get infected? Yes, he can. Sometimes what happens, you have a patient of dry eye for years. You've been treating him with different medicines and keeping him going in the sense that he continues to pay consultation fee regularly every few months that you call him. And you are happy, patient is happy. Suddenly the patient feels that his symptoms are worsened. He calls you up. Now he's been your patient for 5 years. You know he's a patient of dry eye, he calls you up and he says, I'm feeling worse. You tell him, put the drops more often. Every hourly you put the drops now. He was putting it 5 times a day. Now put it every hour because you assume that a dry eye patient can only get waxing and many of dry eye. Nothing else can happen, which is not true. Dry eye patients are prone to infections because the ocular surface is compromised. So avoid telephonic treatment and look for coexisting blepharitis. Usually when a dry eye patient becomes worse, there is a blepharitis component which has worsened. So call the patient in, look for meibomitis, look for squamous blepharitis. unless you aggressively treat that and just increase the frequency of the drops, he's not going to get better. So a known dry eye patient presenting with conjunctivitis is not uncommon. However, don't overdo antibiotics, because these patients can go into dry complications and become worse dry eye much easier. So topical antibiotics, especially aminoglycosides, are toxic. What are aminoglycosides? Your topramycin and your gentamicin. They're toxic to the surface and can worsen a dry eye. So treat aggressively for a week or so and abruptly stop antibiotics. There is no such thing in the world as tapering of antibiotics. There is only stop. Antibiotics can never be tapered. Steroids must be tapered. So these are some take-home messages. And continue the lubricants even when the antibiotics are on. So in spite of antibiotics, please continue the lubricants, because basically he is your patient of dry eye. Then the other combination, allergy and infection, can they occur? So we talked about allergy and dry eye. We talked about infection and dry eye. Now allergy and infection, the other combination, can it occur? Yes. Who are our prime allergy patients? These kind of kids. Kids go around, run in the sand, run in the mud, and the hygiene is not the world's best hygiene. So they often rub their eyes with dirty fingers because they got itching. So there is no reason why they can't get infection. Suspect coexisting infection on phone. If parents tell you the eye discharge is different, what will the parents tell you? Because sir, he used to get a little watery discharge with the itching, but now there is a little mucopurulent discharge. Nowadays we've got phone pictures on WhatsApp. The IMA doesn't encourage this. Sometimes you can't help it. So ask them to send a picture and then call the patient over. Don't prescribe on the phone. So treat as coexisting infection if besides the papillae, the rest of the conjunctiva is red or inflamed. In an allergic eye, you don't get the whole eye inflamed ever. So you can give a short course of frequent topical antibiotics. Most important is let the allergy treatment continue. So this is combination of allergy and infection. So avoid aggressive steroid therapy in diagnostic dilemmas. So sometimes, as I said, you can get allergy with infection, allergy with dry eye with infection. All these combinations can occur. But careful history taking, using your ears and putting the patient in front of you and examining him, you'll come to know which of the two or the three or all three are present. Don't do shotgun therapy with steroids, which most people are wanting to, because steroids will suppress everything. Then we'll see after a week. So they only suppress the symptoms and sometimes result in new infections on stoppage. So avoid this shotgun therapy. I've seen patients on anti-infectives, antifungals, antivirals, antibiotics, everything. So they are a sure recipe for conjunctivitis medicamentosa. This patient is going to land up with problems. So to conclude, allergy plus dry eye, infection plus dry eye, allergy plus infection can coexist. Learn to recognize and treat. Avoid telephonic diagnosis and treatment of chronic dry eye patients or chronic allergy patients. Don't overdo anti-infective treatment. 1 week is max. Don't taper topical antibiotics. And beware all the time of conjunctivitis medicamentosa. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Maskati. So as you saw, that was a very nice practical approach to treatment of the patients, and also a very interesting talk. It's our honor and privilege to have with us Dr. Shizuka Ko, and she's going to give a keynote address at the end of the session. But I request her to please join us on the dais, Dr. Ko. And Dr. Umang Mathur unfortunately came down with a flu, and he called last night that he has fever. He was hoping to get better enough to take the flight this morning, but he couldn't. So he has sent his slides, and Dr. Sonia from Shroff Eye Center will be presenting. So that's going to cover OST masquerades as well as meibomianitis. As Dr. Maskati explained, there's blepharitis and an associate component of meibomian gland dysfunction in many of the patients, and Dr. Sonia will be covering the dilemmas as well as some practical approach to diagnosis. Thank you.
So good morning everybody, and because Dr. Umang was down with fever, I have to present his slides. So we'll be talking today about OST masquerades. Dry eye is a very common entity, and we see it very commonly in our clinics. But many a times what seems as a dry eye is not just a dry eye. So in amidst of a lot of sheep, sometimes there is a wolf. and we have to know when and how to identify that wolf. So we have to know when to not lose the way and just treat the dry eye. So as all of us know this flow chart, dry eye is mainly aqueous deficient and evaporative dry eye. So we'll be coming back to this again and again. I'll be first of all aqueous deficient dry eye when there is decrease in the quantity of tears. That is aqueous deficient dry eye, which is mainly Sjögren syndrome dry eye or non-Sjögren's dry eye. So starting with this case, it is a 50-year-old female who presented with us with pain, redness, diminution of vision, and watering in one eye. And she presented as this epithelial defect, which looked like a long-standing epithelial defect, a persistent epithelial defect. Apparently, 1 month back, accidentally, she had put some Ayurvedic medication, which we don't know what it is, in the right eye. And then she was diagnosed with a total corneal abrasion and was put on the treatment for the corneal abrasions with all of the all sorts of treatment, but she worsened over the time. We don't know about what Ayurvedic medication was she on. So now what it is? It's not healing with the treatment, with the conventional treatment. Now it's very important to see what is there in the fellow eye. The fellow eye might seem all right, but we have to see what is there in the fellow eye. And on the examination, the fellow eye, we could see these SPKs and severe dry eye also in the fellow eye. On taking a history, she had a history of multiple joint pains, morning stiffness from last 10 years, for which she was taking some Ayurvedic medication, but she had no relief. She also had a history of dry eye, dry mouth off and on. So we did a rheumatoid arthritis RA factor and ESR, and it was positive. And we treated this patient with a TABCL in the right eye and the treatment for RA immunosuppression for the left eye. So now we know that it was not just a dry eye. It was a rheumatoid arthritis associated dry eye, which could have led to perforation if not treated on time. Then the second case is 65-year-old male. He underwent a left eye cataract surgery somewhere else, and after 1 week of cataract surgery, he developed pain, redness, irritation, and diminution of vision in the left eye. He consulted his operating ophthalmologist, and but there was no improvement in his condition. He kept on worsening. Then he presented to us with this picture. We can see some sterile infiltrates and melt in the left eye. Now, when we go ahead and check the other eye, what is the status of the other eye? It is an empty socket. So we can't leave it like that. It is an empty socket, but why? So we went ahead and took a history. Our patient also had the similar kind of a history in the right eye. He had cataract surgery 6 months back, followed with he developed keratitis in the right eye, and which could not be treated properly, and went ahead to evisceration. Patient also gave us a history of irritation and foreign body sensation in the right left eye also at that time. So he had got all these treatment, but ultimately he had to undergo evisceration. So on prodding further in this case, there is also history of multiple joint pains involving small joints of hand around 2 years back. Patient is not taking any medication for that, and there is history of dry mouth since few years. We did the investigation, and the RA factor came out to be positive with a high ESR. So the diagnosis was rheumatoid arthritis related sterile corneal melt with dry eye. So whenever we do a pre-operative workup of a cataract surgery, it is very important to take care of these things. And if the patient is significantly complaining of this irritation and dry eye, we should try and look out for the cause if the patient is having it in both eyes. So if patient is turns out to be a RA or any other systemic autoimmune disease, then we should be controlling it properly before going ahead with the surgery, because surgery can cause an increase in the activity and can lead to sterile melts. Now this is the same patient after 3 months with the visual acuity of 6x36 and with corneal scarring, and patient is on methotrexate and folic acid with topical lubrication. Now this is another case of 55-year-old female with complaints of pain and watering in both eyes since 1 month. She presented with the right eye epithelial defect and peripheral thinning with scleritis. In the left eye, there was a corneal scar with SPKs, and AC was deep and quiet. We went ahead, did some investigations. The CNK was turned out to be positive. The other investigations were normal. So it was a case of Wegener's granulomatosis, and the ANCA, the anti-nuclear antibody titers, are usually raised in Wegener's granulomatosis, and they tend to increase with the activity of the disease and they fall with the remission of the disease. And they are very specific and sensitive for the patients with scleritis. So in our case, there was no other systemic finding of Wegener's granulomatosis, but only scleritis. And the patient was started on immunosuppression. This is a picture 6 weeks after immunosuppression. The inflammation is getting controlled. And this is 4 months, the condition was under control. There was a vascularized corneal scar in the right eye. And the next plan was to do a phaco with IOL under the steroid cover. And this is the picture after the cataract surgery, when the patient was completely controlled on immunosuppression, then the cataract surgery was planned. So there are a few serum antibodies which are important in the Sjögren syndrome, which we should know of. They are anti-nuclear antibodies, the RA factor, and the Sjögren syndrome specific antibodies.
Sonia, could you wrap up now and then go for the next talk? Okay.
So just maybe
just quickly go over the next few slides.
Okay. So actually the next we'll be talking about the non-Sjögren syndrome. I'll just go with the cases fast. So corneal anesthesia, this is the worst form of dry eye, and many a times it may result in a neurotrophic keratopathy. In evaporative dry eye, one of the most common is the meibomian oil deficiency or the meibomian gland disease, which leads to evaporative dry eye. What meibomian glands do, they secrete the oily layer of the tear, which reduces the evaporation of the tears. So if in case they are inflamed or the secretion is blocked, then we get meibomian gland disease. This is a case of 52-year-old gentleman with meibomian gland disease, blockage of the meibomian orifice we can see, and the frothy discharge. But along with this, he had these eruptions on the face in the sun. And so this is a case of rosacea. It is not just a meibomian gland deficiency. It is a case of rosacea, and it is a primarily cutaneous vascular disorder which triggers due to alcohol, hot beverages, tobacco, spicy food, and it is a type 4 cell-mediated hypersensitivity reaction. So in meibomian gland cases, we should look for this disease. Then there are disorders of lid aperture. So sometimes what we see is the SPKs on the eye. So SPKs can be there due to dry eye caused by some lid disorders like essential blepharospasm and all. And sometimes we think that the patient is blinking excessively due to the dry eye. So sometimes it's the dry eye causing the lid problems, and sometimes the lid problems are causing the dry eye. So this is a patient who had extensive SPKs in her eyes. The video's not playing. So in this case, actually this case was, it was an essential blepharospasm patient. I need to see the previous video. And okay, sorry, the video, I think it's in there but not playing. So this patient was having a essential blepharospasm, continuous blinking of the eyes, and we went ahead and did a Botox therapy for him, for her, and after this, this is a post-Botox video and she is very comfortable. You would be able to appreciate if I can show the pre-Botox video. No, I need the video which I have uploaded in the preview. The pre-Botox video. Okay. Yeah, I got it. So, you can just leave it, I'll do it. Yeah, thank you. This is the patient. She presented like this, continuous blinking of eye and with corneal SPKs. So this is a essential blepharospasm patient, and the video I showed next was after we did a Botox therapy for her, and now she's comfortable and the corneas are also better. So in this case, the cornea condition is not leading to the excessive blinking, but the excessive blinking is leading to disruption of the tear film, leading to an evaporative dry eye. Again, going back to the presentation. I have to skip a few slides. I think that was all mainly. So so the dry eye is a multifactorial disease. Dry eye is a multifactorial disease of tears and ocular surface that results in symptoms of discomfort, visual disturbance, and tear film instability with potential damage to ocular surface. It is accompanied by increased osmolarity of the tear film and the inflammation of ocular surface. These two things are very important in dry eye, which leads to the signs and the symptoms of the dry eye. Thanks a lot.
Sure, Dr. Sonia, I really appreciate your having stepped in and given such a wonderful talk and covered the topic so well. And it's given me a good way to go ahead with my talk, which is on osmolarity.
Thank you, ma'am. So much. Thank you.
Professor Radhika Tandon will now talk to you, will brief us on hyperosmolarity or osmoprotection. Is it a myth or reality?
Thank you so much. A lot of discussion in this instruction course is going to involve using medications. I'd like to just say that we don't have any specific financial interest with any product. And we've tried to give you initially a little bit about the diagnosis, but of course, in your clinic, you will find a whole variation of patients. And sometimes, as the previous speakers have said, you're really not sure, is it the dryness, is it the infection, and which is the cause and which is the effect. And hopefully at the end of this course, you'll have some kind of a systematic thinking and go step by step in how to handle such patients. Now, talking about hyperosmolarity and osmoprotection, so these are words everybody is already familiar with and everybody has read a lot and already knows about it. So why should we have this this discussion? It's just basic to see that, is it just something that is totally theoretical? Is is it really just a myth that we've been told, and does it actually happen in practice? The world is changing. There's a changing climate, not only around us, but also in our own lives. There's change in the environment, there's a lot of pollution, and there's also lifestyle changes. And how is the tear film exposed to this? It is a complex ecosystem, and though it's very much inside the body, but it does engage a lot with the environment, and you'll be surprised to know how day-to-day activities can affect the tear film. There is a very delicate balance. It's a very small ecosystem, but it's very, very tuned. And then there could be inflammation, which could be local and systemic. And what are the new frontiers, as both in terms of diagnosis and therapy, and what is the industrial impact, not only in terms of occupational disorders, but also what is the industry providing us in handling such patients? So knowledge is, of course, an easy solution, but the knowledge sometimes is confusing. You don't know what to balance, what particular approach to take. But you have to have a little basic rationale for the etiopathogenesis, because that gives your mind some kind of thinking or some kind of logical approach to the patient. And also, the etiopathogenesis should encourage us to do modes for prevention. That's something that we can work for, not only for our patients, but also in our own lives, because we also as doctors are exposed to all the diseases that our patients can get. Drug discovery, targeted therapy, and a healthy lifestyle, diet, and other preventive measures. So as far as the pathophysiology is concerned, there are certain aspects which are unclear, certain suggestive, certain which are mostly consistent, and over the previous talks, you've learned what are the big bugbears, or the usual culprits in causing dry eye, and then they lead to this kind of deficiency, which is, as you know, aqueous or evaporative. But ultimately, you have a decrease in tear film volume, and as a result of that, you get a hyperosmolarity, and this is regarded as a central mechanism. It's just the hyperosmolarity per se, but it triggers a whole set of mechanisms on the ocular surface as a cascade of inflammatory events. So as I said before, is it the dry eye leading to the inflammation? Is it the inflammation leading to the dry eye? And the answer is both. And it's the history and your approach to the patient which will help you identify which came first and which is escalating or exacerbating the other. There is an activation of matrix proteinases and various signaling pathways with the generation of inflammatory cytokines, and it is important to bear this in mind because when you're seeing a patient with a dry eye, you're deciding whether to put a punctal plug. Bear in mind that if there are a lot of inflammatory cytokines on the surface and you plug the drainage, then those cytokines are going to remain on the surface for longer. And these inflammatory events lead to apoptotic death of the surface epithelial cells that we knew, but also the goblet cells. So we used to think that aqueous deficient dry eye, mucin deficient dry eye, and evaporative dry eye. But even these kind of dry eyes can lead to mucin deficiency as well. And some of the agents that we have now can take care of this. There is a tear film instability. It is seen in patients with evaporative dry eye, and it is triggered by meibomian gland dysfunction. And it can also be the initiative event in post-LASIK surgery, vitamin A deficiency, allergic conjunctivitis, topical preservative use, and contact lens wear. And the last two I would like to highlight, because we may be prescribing contact lenses for patients. We may be using drugs for, as I attended the previous session on uveitis, and they were talking about putting the steroids every minute for 5 minutes, and then every 15 minutes for 2 hours, and then every hour for 3 days. So you can imagine the whole load of preservatives in such patients. And also glaucoma patients who are on chronic use. So therefore, these are the situations that we need to be alert for. And even after cataract surgery, you can have dry eye precipitated. So just to explain, we have this inflammatory cocktail which is floating around in the tear fluid. It's a toxic tear fluid which is decreased quantity, which is decreased quality, and delayed clearance and increased residence time. So we need to keep this all in mind. Now with the DEWS 2, 10 years after the previous DEWS of 2007, we have now the DEWS 2. The objective one was to create evidence-based definition and a contemporary classification. Central concept has been recognized as loss of homeostasis of the tear. tier film. Looking at the previous history, there was initially the definition 1995, then 2006 the Delphi Consensus Group, and 2007. So over the last 10 years it has taken to come now to the effect of 2017. It is a little simplified. It has addressed the multifactorial nature. The role of inflammation and hyperosmolarity is now ingrained in the definition, showing that the knowledge is more and it is more strong. It also has included expected outcomes as well as etiology. It also included symptoms. Symptoms plays an important role, and the role of neurosensory abnormality, as you realize, in some of the masquerade syndromes. So this is the definition, and the objective to also assess the etiology, mechanism, distribution, and impact, and also address the management and therapy. So there is this very nice cartoon which tells you how to approach the patient, and I would like to highlight here through my talks few aspects of this. So you have a patient who is presenting, and how will you approach the patient? You will see whether the patient is asymptomatic and symptomatic. Now what about the asymptomatic patient? This is important if the patient is going for cataract surgery, if there's a glaucoma patient whom you're going to put on medication. So these are the ones whom you must also look carefully on the slit lamp to see if you're going to precipitate a problem by your therapy. And then you would see whether the patient has signs without symptoms, and whether the patient has a neurotrophic condition or a dysfunctional sensation, where actually there are the patient is asymptomatic but there are signs. So maybe the patient has a herpetic eye disease or a sensory problem with the fifth nerve. Symptomatic patients, again, then you will see what are the signs, what are the symptoms. There are triaging questions which I shall go over further. And if there are no signs, then you have to look whether it could be a case of neuropathic pain. And then the dry eye disease is not mutually exclusive. As we explained before, you could have a combination of aqueous and evaporative, and as I told you, even mucin deficiency can result as a consequence. So now what about the tear film osmolarity? Several people who may have actually used this diagnostic kit may be a little disappointed to find that the values vary too much, and you cannot always titrate your treatment based on that. But that itself is intrinsic to the disease. So you may have repeated measurements and you may have variability. And it is that variability which is in fact supportive of the dry eye state. So normal subjects will have a low osmolarity or a normal osmolarity, which is relatively stable every time you check it. Whereas heteroskosky dysplasticity is an increasing variation with an increasing value of the hyperosmolarity, indicating a dry eye state. The other thing is between eye differences. So you may have the value below 308, but the difference between the two eyes may be more than 8 milliosmoles per liter. This is also considered as an indication of loss of tear film homeostasis and occurs with dry eye disease. Now the triaging questions is what you will do. You have a systematic approach, not do the whole battery of tests on everybody. To a risk factor analysis, don't forget to ask about smoking, contact lens use, and chronic medications. And then you have the symptomatology. You can either use the DEQ5 or OSDI, and if it's more than equal to 6 or 13, it's abnormal. And then you can do one of the additional tests, either a non-invasive TBOT, which would be less than 10 seconds. You can do the osmolarity, and you can do ocular surface staining. In case a non-invasive TBOT is not available, you can do the fluorescein test, but that is recommended to go in sequence as after the osmolarity. So if you are going to use fluorescein to do the TBOT and you want to do an osmolarity as well, you will do the osmolarity first. Okay, so that comes to tear osmolarity. The cells require stable osmotic environment. The use of tear osmolarity in the diagnosis, you fortify. A whole lot of articles have been published. And osmolarity generally increases with the disease severity. As I said once before, a non-invasive BOT can be done. These are your triaging questions. It's there in the publication, which you can look up, how severe, how long, any other symptoms. And the cutoff values will take 308. And it's bound to be fairly valuable in identifying mild to moderate and severe dry eye if it's more than 336. Now, just a few slides on the treatment of this hyperosmolarity, and what about using osmoprotectants, the role of compatible solutes. Now, as I explained, when you have hyperosmolarity, the cells get dehydrated. There is a degranulation within the cells and a production of inflammatory kinds. If you're able to bypass them by hydrating the cells without affecting the cellular metabolism, that that is the key. And that can be achieved by certain agents called compatible solutes. What are they? Carnitine, glycerin, and erythritol, and trehalose. These are examples. And pro-inflammatory markers and an innate inflammation in dry eye disease has confirmed the help of such agents in controlling the inflammation and increasing the tear film's instability. However, there's a whole plethora of agents available in the market, and it depends upon the study that you're looking at. Generally, you would work on tear osmolarity has led to a better understanding. It is, as far as tear osmolarity, you can say it's a useful non-essential tool, and osmoprotectants usage is to be encouraged in cases of dry eye. Thank you. So with that, we now come to the next talk by Dr. Vanathi, and she's going to take it forward and give you a practical guide as to which tear substitutes to use in which situations and what dosage.
Okay. Dr. Vanathi will give both her talks back to back. So she'll talk about cyclosporine as well, and management pearls, how to choose the appropriate artificial tear drops. One easy way of choosing artificial teardrops is to decide depending on which medical rep has visited you last. She'll give you the more complex solution.
Thank you for being with us on this morning, and it's always nice to see a lot of people in a dry eye session. I think my previous speakers have made my job very easy, so I'll pick up the string from where Dr. Radhika left it. So my task today is to tell you how to go about choosing an artificial teardrop. And believe me, that's how I always land up wherever you look at a challenging case in your clinic, because the options are all so confusing. You have the industry bombarding us with so many medications, and one is always left or spoiled for choices so badly that you really do not know what is the right choice which is going to be working optimally or increase the success rate of your management of a particular case of dry eye disease. So what you look at, what are the constituents of a particular dry eye medication, is going to be the polymer in the medication, it's going to be the preservative in the medication, and it's going to be the buffer agent or the oil or the gelling agents which add on to the tonicity and the viscosity of the medication which you're going to be using for the particular patient. So this is a busy slide here, a wonderful flow chart which sort of summarizes what medication is perhaps going to be better or best, and it has to be applied in what scenario of the dry eye disease. So as we all know that there are two components of an evaporative dry eye disease or a tear deficient dry eye disease, and these could be caused by multifactorial morbidities here. So what particularly needs to be addressed when you're looking at a patient is what is the problem which is causing this dry eye manifestation in this particular patient who's sitting in front of you and is being unhappy and moving from one doctor to another doctor perhaps. So you have to identify that in order to be successful to the kind of medication you need to choose for this particular patient. But remember, the bottom line is whatever be the morbidity which is causing, what it is particularly doing is altering the tonicity of the tears. So it's making your tears hypertonic, or the osmolarity of the tears is getting altered by this particular disease. And this altered hypertonicity or the hyperosmolarity of the tears fits into a particularly vicious cycle, which is what leading to the symptoms by nature of which the patient is presenting to us. So it's tear hyperosmolarity leading on to inflammation, release of inflammatory mediators, and those directly, indirectly and directly damaging the ocular surface, the tear film and the ocular surface epithelial cells, contributing or worsening to the tear film instability. So once you understand this particular vicious cycle and you're able to identify at what phase of this cycle the patient is presenting to you, you would probably be nail on, or you will be able to target your therapy better and bring in a better success for your particular patient. Just a small word is, today understanding tear film has become more complex. It's a complex entity now, so it's not just a simple thing which is altering. It's been broken down to a complex molecular understanding. I'll leave you to go back and read those to enhance your understanding. But what has changed today in the management of dry eye is moving from looking at a patient when he is symptomatic and managing a dry eye disease when the patient is becoming asymptomatic to us, that is before he's going to manifest with significant ocular surface damage. That is when you want to identify, pick him up and treat for better success and decrease the morbidity of the disease. Practically, what we are seeing today in most of our practices, I'm not going to talk to you about the particular or the severe ocular morbidity diseases which cause dry eye disease, but by and large, which most of the practitioners would see in your practice is your meibomian gland disease, and your, which is causes an evaporative dry eye disease and an aqueous deficiency dry eye disease. You would see by and large, there is about a 30 to 70% overlap. So you might have one of these two components in the particular patient you're looking at, and just addressing one perhaps is not going to be useful in managing this. So these are the various factors you need to look at. You need to look at the polymer, what is the preservative, what is the electrolyte content in the drop you're choosing, what is the osmolarity, how is it going to change by using this medication, what is the viscosity of this. Of course, cost plays a major factor, but by and large, what I still feel is, what is the patient comfortable with on using it? What works in one perhaps does not work in the other. So this is how these various factors which I spoke to you about function in enhancing the ocular surface or in enhancing the comfort of the ocular surface. To make it more practical is, what are the factors you need to consider when you're choosing eye drops for therapy for dry eye? Factor one is, please do not use any medications which are going to decrease conjunctival hyperemia. These vasoconstricting agents is not going to help, and it probably is going to give you a little dry eye, but the patient is not going to be comfortable in the long run. Two is, identify what is important, and I think Dr. Muscati wonderfully showed those clinical sites to say, identify what is the pathology you're dealing with, and unless and until you're going to hit target on managing that pathology, just giving lubricant drops is not going to be the answer. It's going to be a short-lived comfort for the patient. He's going to come back to you, I was happy the first week, I was happy the first 10 days, but I'm not happy anymore, doctor, and you're not able to treat me. So that is by and large the most important reason why it fails. And the three again is, if there is a particular disease which needs long-term medications, and most of our patients are chronic glaucoma patients, and chronic glaucoma medications and the preservatives in those medications, or any other disease which is warranting long-term therapy, can lead to the preservative-induced damage, and that's something which needs to be taken care of. I'll shortly come on to that. And the other factor you need to look at is whether you need to do just drops or whether you should give ointments for these patients. So what are the polymers you have with them? You are again spoiled for choices. You have HPMC, CMCs, carbomers, polyvinyl alcohols, pyrrolidins, and hyaluronic acids, dextrans. So the choices are multiple here, and they are basically based on two classifications, whether they are neutral charge particles or polyelectrolyte charge particles, all performing the very important task of enhancing the ocular surface viscosity here and also improving the wettability of the ocular surface. And most of them come by and large with some form of a true preservative-free medication. It's still by and large not a reality. They do come back with a lot of preservatives, so that's something you need to consider. What is the preservative in this, and is it going to add on to the toxicity of what this patient is already using? This was a wonderful study when I basically went back and looked into what polymer is perhaps better than the other polymer. I have so many company people coming and sitting in my office and telling me to use this or that. So I went in and read this particular paper, and I would recommend you to look at this as well. And this talks about complex calculations which are beyond my comprehensive understanding here. But then the bottom line, or the take-home message it gives you, it talked about the comfort indices, calculation of comfort indices using various medications, which is a wonderfully done research here. And to my pleasant surprise, I did find that the comfort index of hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose and carboxymethyl cellulose, HPMC, still seem to score slightly over the OCMC. That's why I always wonder, my patients, when they are still on HPMC, which was one of the earlier introductions, are still happy with what they are using, because the comfort index values of these are almost as similar as well. But what we have in the Alma meter is the newer one, is the high hyaluronic acid here, which has a higher, a better wettability and a better retainability on the ocular surface and a better comfort index compared to the others which we have with them with us today. So by and large, this is the pyramid which you need to concentrate on when you're choosing medications. And what does your medication need to do is to increase the already damaged tear film thickness, protect the ocular surface epithelial cells from further drying, help in the retention of the surface on the ocular surface, protect the ocular surface as well, retain or bring back the physiological conditions of the tear and the corneal thickness, improve goblet cell function, and relieve dry eye symptoms out here. So what you need to understand, this is a normal ocular surface here, but because of the hypertonic damage, the surface breaks down, the epithelial cells undergo desiccation, leading to damage, corneal staining and conjunctival staining. So when you are giving a drop here, what happens, it tends to rejuvenate and close up all these cracks, which you, if you have to put it in layman's language, on the surface. But what happens is, as soon as the stress is removed, then everything gets fine. But when the stress comes back, then these eyes do not work very well. So that's why we need to look on those which contain polyols, and polyols are amino acids which are additives on the tears, which do get into the cells and help to retain intracellular osmotic strength without damaging the proteins of the cells, and thereby enhance the effect of the medication which you're looking at. This, by and large, is the latest which is available on international literature, which is a PACE bulletin, is a recommendation of what medication you would like to choose first, why and when, which will be the first line, second line. So go back and do read about them. I think lack of time, I will stop short here on how hyaluronic acid works, and I'll just move on, just a couple of slides to show on cyclosporin here, out here, because that's something which many of us are using as immunomodulating medications in our practice here. And what we actually are looking at, or what, when will cyclosporin act, is cyclosporin does not act in very severe dry eyes. It will be useful in mild and moderate dry eye disease where there is a persisting low-grade inflammation on the ocular surface, and you use it as a steroid-sparing agent to control the ocular surface inflammation and to produce an immunomodulating effect. So that's when cyclosporin is going to be effective, by virtue of it being a powerful T-cell modulator, inhibiting T-cells and interleukin-2 release. So that's when you have to understand that cyclosporin is not there for all patients, and this is the particular bracket of dry eye disease patients who are going to be benefiting when there is a lacrimal gland disease, when there is a tear deficient disease completely, you're not going to have your cyclosporin working at all. So it particularly works well in contact lens intolerant patients with dry eye disease, in chronic VKC patients where the morbidity has had read on to a dry eye disease, atopic keratoconjunctivitis, allergic conjunctivitis, superior limbic conjunctivitis. And just to close with a small study which we looked at to see if this is really helping, it does help in chronic glaucoma patients who are on anti-glaucoma therapy for a long, long while. And when we did look at their ocular surface imaging, we looked at their corneal imaging by their subepithelial nerve fiber layer plexus imaging, we did find that there was a definite increase in the corneal subbasal nerve fiber layer before using cyclosporin and after using cyclosporin. So that the inflammatory component, when it gets controlled, is affording better health of the ocular surface, better health of the nerves innervating the ocular surface, and that is a sort of targeting or helping in improving the pathogenesis of a dry eye disease. So this, in nutshell, is to help you to understand how to tailor your medications to better effect in managing your dry eye patients. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vanathi. So we have an idea about the topical treatment and the conventional treatments that we have. And we go ahead with the lecture by Dr. Rohit Shetty, who's going to share the inflammation connection, share experience with using another agent for giving comfort to our patients. And after that, we'll have Dr. Rajesh Sinha, who's going to talk about hydroxychloroquine, post-surgical, and then Dr. Mascati will take the very important topic of ribamipide. And after that, we'll have time for questions, and we'll have the keynote address. We'll have the keynote address followed by a combined panel of questions.
It's on. At the onset, I'd like to thank Dr. Radhika and Dr. Kuresh for giving me this opportunity to share our work of vitamin D3. No financial interest in this presentation. This was one of the first paper which made us to start looking at is there a role of vitamin D3 in ocular surface or corneal pathology. It's a very interesting paper published in IVOVS. What it really says is the epithelial cells of cornea have receptors for vitamin D. We call it as vitamin D receptors, and they are known to produce vitamin D without the need of sunlight, and they don't need to go through the same metabolism what we see in our entire body. That means that God does not give anything, any function in our body without a reason. I'm sure even appendix also had a reason for many, many thousands of years back. Then we started looking at if it has to be there, if there is a receptor there. If you have a receptor, it means it has something which is doing. So we started moving forward on this. Then we started looking at multiple other pub people were also looking at the same direction. They're trying to figure out if there is a casual link, because many times we find links to everything. If you really want to, when you do research, you can link up virtually everything. But we wanted to know whether it's just an isolated find or if something truth to it. This was some 6 to 7 years back. And when I used to start this presentation, the first question people would ask me is, this is not true. You don't, it's just a casual link, because 80% of Indians are vitamin D deficient. We don't know what is the level. There's so many other things which were said. Then, if you really ask a scientist, the same analogy works for smokers and lung cancers. All those who smoke don't get lung cancers. And all those who don't smoke, it's not that they're protected from lung cancers. It's just a combination of these three things. Your disease, genetic, and the host. That means a person who develops a deficiency to vitamin D anywhere in the body, from head to toe, has to have a genetic defect which can manifest, which can make it exaggerated. That means you have a deficiency, I have a deficiency, nothing happens, you have a deficiency, and you have a vitamin D or one of these genetics which is not proper, then you can have a huge difference in the way you give the disease. And these are all the issues which can happen. Enough publication from, say, retina, from axial length. A lot of people started looking at this as one of the areas. And myopia and sunlight, why you need to spend 2 hours according to your ATOM studies, also related to this, because vitamin D and sunlight is known to increase dopamine, and dopamine is a protectant against axial length growth. These are some of our work from the time we started, just as a casual to as we go on, what we have been doing. Let me just, because this is an ocular surface related one, let me just start with dry eye. We started looking at what does vitamin D actually do in dry eye. One of the things which actually does is, Dr. Vanathi showed some good confocal image, I'm showing some. It brings in the dendritic cells. Dendritic cells are the Langerhans cells which are in the periphery, but when there is some kind of a trigger, they come into the center. These white things are the dendritic cells. And these, the vitamin D receptors is known to attract, or when there is a change, it's known to bring them into the cornea. And when you do that, they start having more and more nociceptive issues. And these are all our patients where you can see that these comes very close to the nerves. Ones which are closer to the nerves are the ones which irritate more. They're the ones patient who keep complaining that none of the drops work. So we call it as a nociceptive. So what happens when you actually treat them? You can see that the nerves are fragile, they don't look healthy, and they are more pain. And you can see that 6 months after treatment, they start getting better. Because once these dendrites go off, there is a crosstalk of how the nerves behave. Now, nerves are not normally in function, it's as though it's been cut by LASIK surgery. We also took the tears, we analyzed them for different pathways, and you can see that there are more of patients who have more nociceptive. That means they irritate your eyes much more. The second talk is about wound modulators. the vitamin D receptors on the surface help to heal better. So it is, for me, it's one of the most important thing when you're looking at, say, PRK or a collagen cross-linking. Because more the haze means that there's some factors which is helping here. This is a work done in 2015 where they talk about the myofibroblast. The myofibroblast, what you see as corneal haze, is excess of myofibroblasts which don't go away. That means they remain there. And this is what we are worried about in any wound healing. And this is exactly the pathway what really works. So what we did was we created an experiment just to prove what we have been saying for all. These are all new things. These are all the collagen and the lysyl oxidase. This is an in vitro model. We started creating the same amount of dry eye inflammation what we see. And you can see that inflammation changes everything. The collagen, lysyl oxidase and everything which changes. Now comes to the important thing. If we are able to bring in a drops of vitamin D, and does it really change? So what we started doing is, this is in vitro model, this on the patient yet. We started using these drops, and very interestingly, this is a graph. This is your collagen, this is a vitamin D receptors. When you induce hyperosmolality, exactly like what we induce in a dry eye, you can see that the collagen and the vitamin D just drops down. That means inflammation changes it. But when you use these drops, you can see that the collagen also increases and the vitamin D receptors also increase. So that means that just this drop in vitro model actually makes it work better. This is exactly the same modeling video. This is the experiment what we did on an in vitro model. These are all the receptors which is present on the corneal epithelial cells. And that means the inflammation would change. Hyperosmolarity changes a lot of stress-related ones. And being an immunomodulator, these drops actually increases the receptors more and it changes the whole pathways of collagen. So that means that there is a tremendous role of these drops once it's commercially available. So this is my last slide. So where are we now? We finished the laboratory study, we put on a patent, we are working on an animal study. At this point of time, it's not irritating the rabbits. We don't, and we have to keep doing it to then we see whether it's changing the pathways, then the clinical trials. It's at least 1 or 2 years from the real picture. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rohit, for the excellent presentation. And that gives us a good background to go ahead for the next talk, which is Dr. Rajesh Sinha, who's going to cover topical chloroquine. And Dr. Rajesh, can you be a little bit less than 7 minutes because we have the keynote address as well. Thank you.
Yeah. There will be question and stand.
At the outset, I would like to thank Professor Radhika Tandon for involving me in this course. I'll be talking a little bit about post-surgical ocular homeostasis and then how chloroquine helps in these cases. Now, basically, if you do any surgery, whether it's a cataract surgery or a retinal surgery or glaucoma surgery, the basic idea of any surgeon is to attain a good vision, well-centered lens, nice flap, of LASIK and a good bleb after glaucoma surgery. And then when we achieve all these, we are very happy. But many times patients are not happy because now very often we have seen now that the patients have symptoms of discomfort. And symptoms of irritation, redness, foreign body sensation, they can be seen after any cataract surgery or retinal surgery, glaucoma surgery. And that is a major cause of patient dissatisfaction because these days we have attained the goal of achieving 6/6 vision and N6 vision in most of our cases. And the basic reason for all these is disturbed ocular surface homeostasis, which is because of inadequate ocular surface hydration. So what happens in LASIK? In LASIK, you cut a flap, create a flap, so you cut the nerves. This is the neuronal loop which you cut, and that results in dry eye. Now, this was a survey done after LASIK, which they found out that 21% of dissatisfied patient due to LASIK was because of dry eye. So that's a huge number. Similarly, a cataract patient, because of his age, which is the age wherein MGD is quite high, you can have coexisting glaucoma, and you alter the curvature. Many times you cut the nerves by, you know, creating additional procedures like LRI. So all these factors, they result in dry eye and ocular surface disturbance. Same is for glaucoma. We use antimitotic agents. We have a large bleb and causes fast breakup time. And in retinal procedure also, it has been noted that in eyes which have undergone VR surgery with silicone oil injection, they have higher chance of dry eye. And post-operatively, all these patients, they get some drugs, and that causes toxicity. So a lot of studies, a lot of research has been done in this field. There has been many concepts in order to address the problems. And one of the concept is the development of this quotient, that is ocular homeostasis and hydration quotient, wherein you have a certain numerator which is favorable for the ocular surface, and the denominator is one which affects badly, adversely, the ocular surface. And the management, I'm not going into details because it has already been discussed. We use the lubricants, carboxymethyl cellulose or hyaluronic acid. And in order to reduce inflammation, Dr. Vanathi was presenting about cyclosporin, topical steroid, omega-3 fatty acids. So all these things have come up. Now, there has been an issue because people still feel, in spite of all these medications, there is something which is missing. And then what actually happened that, you know, patients who were using chloroquine, systemic chloroquine, which is a well-known anti-malarial drug, they got some benefit in dry eye. In Sjogren syndrome, systemic hydroxychloroquine was being used, and they found out that there is some benefit in terms of symptoms, in terms of the signs of dry eye. And then from there, people started working, doing research, and they found out that what should be the, what is the exact mechanism. So what they found out that normally when there's any inflammation, there are macrophages, neutrophils, on the surface, and they liberate metalloproteases and they cause apoptosis of surface epithelial cells. And chloroquine inhibits the release of metalloprotease, and this perhaps reduces the apoptosis of the ocular surface and thereby the symptoms related to dry eye. And then a lot of studies were initiated, and initially there was animal study in terms of safety, in terms of efficacy. They found out that chloroquine is effective. Then they did the safety trial on animals, and they found out that it was quite safe. There was no adverse effect. Then they started doing the human trial, and the phase one study was done. Although the number was less initially, but they found out that there was definite improvement in symptomatology, and there was no adverse reaction as far as the use of chloroquine is concerned. And they were, in terms of improvement in ocular surface issues, they found out that there was definite improvement in breakup time, and there was improvement in Schirmer's value. There was improvement in the staining that was seen in these ocular surface disorders because of apoptosis, and there was no adverse effect. This was one of the major studies which found out that there was significant improvement in breakup time, Schirmer's test, fluorescein staining, symptoms, and in microscopic examination, they found out that the apoptosis was significantly reduced, and the study felt that there was definite beneficial effect of chloroquine. And the chloroquine in this study was used for 3 weeks, and the efficacy was detected after 4 weeks. So the study concluded that there's definite effect of hydroxychloroquine in reduction of apoptosis, in reduction of symptoms, in improvement in signs and breakup time, etc., and staining. And it remains at least till 1 week after the cessation of treatment, after withdrawal of treatment. And there was no adverse event seen in this. So finally, most of the studies that have done, they have concluded that apoptosis is an issue in ocular surface disorder, which can result in all these symptoms. And chloroquine phosphate has been found to be useful in reducing apoptosis in order to, you know, reduce symptoms and improve the parameters of ocular surface in dry eye patients. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. I'll request you to stay if you can, because I'm sure there'll be questions for you the end.
Yes.
And with that, we come to Dr. Maskati, we are going to have a brief overview about the role of ribamapide.
Thank you. We talked about cyclosporine. We talked about the chloroquine. And another drug, which is not a lubricant, is ribamapide. So it came in from Japan. Santen Laboratories, I have no financial interest, was the first people to decide that if it works well for the mucus lining of the stomach to prevent peptic ulcers, maybe it has something to do. Can you put on the slides, or do I do it myself? Two. So if it does work for peptic ulcers, maybe it has some role in this. And of course, I'll just run you briefly through. So there is a goblet cell density which goes down in dry eye syndrome, and therefore anything which increases the proliferation of the goblet cells and therefore mucin. See, we have a lot of things for aqueous deficiency, all sorts of water drops, tear drops help in aqueous deficiency. For lipid deficiency, we don't have really much, so we attack the core problem, which is meibomian gland disease, with doxycycline and other things, warm compresses, and hope that the lipid improves. But for mucin, up to now, we didn't have anything which was there. So if mucin secretion can be improved, then perhaps it would help and be fitted somewhere in our... So as I said, it came in Japan. It helps the microvilli. Now, we've got microvilli on these epithelial cells, cornea and the conjunctiva. So those are the building blocks. So on top of that, if you have mucin, the taller the microvilli, it's like when you're building a foundation from below and you need those iron rods on which you put the cement. So the taller the microvilli, the less stunted, and the more the microvilli, the better it is. And in dry eye, the average number of microvilli goes down and the height of the microvilli goes down. And ribamapide helps in both these, and it helps in proliferation of the goblet cells as well. So it increases both the secreted and the membrane-associated, the two types of mucin. We won't go into technical details. It prevents damage to the microvilli and proliferation of this. So in various in vitro studies, it's been found to help in goblet cells and in the microvilli, upregulating the expression of membrane-associated mucin. So it works both on both the types of mucin. It also suppresses ocular surface inflammation like cyclosporine does, and it antagonizes effect of TNF-alpha. So it has an anti-inflammatory effect. So it acts at various pathways. So it gives a 360-degree benefit in these patients. There's been studies which have been done also. Fairly large number of patients, 154 patients. Ribamapide has to be put four times a day. You cannot put it three times. You cannot put it two times. It has to be put four times a day. Teardrops can be put any number of times. But ribamapide is a therapy. Like cyclosporine is a therapy, you need to put twice a day. Like chloroquine is a therapy, you need to put twice a day. Ribamapide has to be put four times a day. It improves your staining scores. It improves the objective and subjective symptoms as well. The breakup time also improves. One side effect that the ribamapide has is that it acts on even on Sjogren's syndrome, whether it's dry eye, dry mouth. Those are difficult cases for dry eye, but ribamapide being added over there does tend to help. I'm not going to all the studies. One good side effect they found that in vernal conjunctivitis, in allergic conjunctivitis, it does tend to help in these patients. Sometimes nothing works except steroids, and it tends to help here as well. So if it's treated with ribamapide, by 14th week, gradually the giant papillae were almost flat. So it's a welcome additive effect. It's not the treatment for vernal conjunctivitis, but it does tend to, you can add it in treatments in patients who are otherwise dependent on steroids. You can try anti-allergic drops and add ribamapide. So to summarize, it's effective in dry eye as well as in vernal conjunctivitis. One drop at a time, four times a day, for minimum 4 weeks. Don't stop till 4 weeks before you declare that it doesn't work. No single medicine works for all patients, whether it is cyclosporine or chloroquine. Remifemide is one more which can be done because there are no other, not much of adverse effects except a bad taste in the mouth. Almost about 20% of the patients have a bad taste. About 10 to 15% of my patients have had to stop remifemide because of a bad taste in the mouth. Otherwise, it's fairly well tolerated. So to summarize, it increases proliferation of goblet cells, works on the mucin layer primarily, but as an anti-inflammatory effect, it also helps in other conditions of dry eye and adds as a welcome addition in patients with vernal conjunctivitis also. So it's one more molecule having a role in dry eye syndromes. Let's use it judiciously for helping our dry eye patients. This is our typical Gujarati thali, which contains multiple foodstuffs. So it's one more in the thali for dry eye patients. So use it judiciously and it will help. It doesn't help, again, I say, in all patients, but in a certain segment, it's worth trying. To just add a word on what Dr. Rajesh said, where you would place the topical chloroquine, I have found with my experience that if a patient complains of photophobia with dry eye, these are the patients who really, chloroquine topical works really well in these patients. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vaskati. That was a very excellent overview about remifemide. And it's my pleasure now to introduce the keynote speaker for this session, Dr. Shizuka Ko, who's from the Osaka University in Japan. Dr. Ko will be talking about the quality of vision in dry eye, a very important topic. And as you know, research in Japan has done a great deal in helping us understand and treat dry eye.
Good morning, everybody. It is my great pleasure to give a talk today.
Request the audiovisual team to please put up the slides. Dr. Ko. Yeah, good.
Okay. Since I have been working in, I'm very interested in visual function associated with tear film and ocular surface. So today, in my talk today, I'd like to share with you the mechanism of visual disturbance in dry eye. So shown here is the latest definition of dry eye by Duce 2. So as stated here, dry eye is accompanied by ocular symptoms, and ocular symptoms include discomfort or visual disturbance, or both remain a central feature of the disease. Actually, there is another definition is already proposed by Asia Dry Eye Society. As stated here, visual impairment is also included in the definition of dry eye. As you know, tear film is very important for maintaining the health of the cornea and conjunctiva. Since tear film is the first reflecting surface of the cornea, it is a very important element of the optical quality for the eye. In healthy eye, smooth tear film is formed by every single blink to create a clear optical surface. But if the tear film evaporates or exposes the irregular optical ocular surface, it results in irregular optical surface which compromise the visual function. Visual complaints are very common among dry eye patients as you experience in your daily clinical practice. It includes fluctuating vision with the blink, glare, blurred vision, and eye fatigue. But actually, these complaints are very common in many of the patients in your eye clinic. So, unfortunately, some dry eye cases may be diagnosed as unidentified troublesome complaints without a definite dry eye diagnosis. So it is very important to note that tear film instability and ocular surface damage are key factors for a core mechanism of dry eye. And vicious cycle between tear film instability and ocular surface damage actually further get worse the dry eye condition. So today, I'd like to speculate the visual disturbance in dry eye based on this core mechanism. As you know, aberrations are in eyes with corneal disorder or ocular surface disorder. Aberrations can be induced by irregularity of the refractive surfaces, such as anterior corneal surface or posterior corneal surface or tear film. So I believe you are familiar with wavefront sensor. So wavefront sensor can evaluate optical quality quantitatively. Aberration includes lower order components and high order components. Standard visual acuity measurement can measure low order components such as spherical or cylinder. But however, it cannot measure higher order components. But with the use of wavefront sensor, it can measure spherical and cylinder and higher order aberrations. Previously, we measured high order aberrations in the eyes with various tear film dynamics. Shown here is a high order case of normal eye without any dry eye. We measured high order aberrations every second after the blink for 10 seconds. So here is you can see the simulated retinal image after the blink, and as you see here, optical quality is stable throughout after the blink. This is the case of normal eye. This is a case of dry eye with decreased wettability. So this condition is characterized usually with decreased wettability, meaning usually showing decreased tear film breakup time. But usually there is no ocular surface staining and Schirmer-Tess value is normal. In this case, you can see the tear film breakup after the, we could see the after the 3 seconds after the blink. As you see here, right after the blink, retinal image quality is good, but you can see the deterioration of the retinal image quality after the blink. So in this case, optical quality degrades with tear film instability. It can explain a fluctuating vision with the blink. This is a case of AKAS deficient dry eye. So tear volume and tear stability, both of them are decreased. And also you can see the corneal staining in the central corneal region. In this case, even right after the blink, retinal image quality is poor and it remained after the blink. So optical quality is impaired throughout after the blink in the AKAS deficient dry eye. It can explain blurred vision of the dry eye patients. Let me move on light scattering. As you know, light scattering is divided into backward light scattering and forward light scattering. Incoming light is coming from this is a scheme of the light scattering and light, and incoming light is coming from the left side. Actually, clinically, forward light scattering is more associated with the patient's symptoms such as glare. There are two commercially available techniques which can measure forward light scattering, double pass imaging and stray light meter. So previously, we measured forward light scattering in dry eye using commercially available stray light meter. So dry eye is subdivided into two groups, dry eye without SPK in the central region and a dry eye with central SPK. And what we found was both dry eye groups had significantly increased forward light scattering than normal eyes. So it means tear film instability is responsible for increase of forward light scattering in dry eye. So this is a potential effect. It shows the potential effect of increased forward light scattering in dry eye. So it can explain the glare symptoms in dry eye. As you know, shown here is a contrast sensitivity chart. Contrast sensitivity provides a measure of the ability to see low contrast patterns, which is actually closer to real world vision. We also measured contrast sensitivity in dry eye patients, and what we found was dry. So this, the blue one is actually dry eye with central SPK, and pink one is a dry eye without central SPK. So what we found was dry eye with SPK in the corneal central corneal region has significantly decreased contrast sensitivity large compared with normal eyes and dry eye without SPK in the corneal central region. It means it explains the blurred vision in dry eye patients, and actually we could say that central SPK affects contrast sensitivity in dry eye. So from the point of so this is my last slide. So from the point optical point of view, mechanism of visual disturbance in dry eye can be explained. So tear film instability actually decreases the stability of the post-blink high order variations, and it explains the fluctuating vision with the blink. And tear film instability increase the forward light scattering in dry eye. It explains glare. And ocular surface damage increased high order variations and decreased contrast sensitivity. It explained blurred vision. So dry eye patients are always actually try to see the object under these conditions, so they feel eye fatigue. So instability of a disrupted tear film over the irregular ocular surface of dry eye is thought to be associated with decreased quality vision. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Koh. So that has very nicely shown with the scientific approach why the patients with dry eye have disturbances with vision. We actually do come to the end of the session with that. We have been told that we have literally 30 seconds more, which probably gives us just enough time to thank all the co-instructors for having given such wonderful talks. We had allowed for an 11 minutes panel discussion, but the scientific committee had to accommodate the keynote. So that is why we've lost some time there. However, we'll encourage you to keep your questions for us and we can take them outside so that we can hand over the hall to the next panel. Immediately.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you,
Dr. Maskati.
Thank you, Dr. Shizuki.
I request all the speakers who are here to please come for a quick group photograph.